Suprabhatam, Suswagatam. Recognition of the three personality traits is the key essence to start the journey in Karma Yoga. The secret to convert every action into a yoga has been depicted in these 18 verses. Having recognized that my tamas is 60%, rajas is 30%, my sattva is only 10%. Having recognized that, we should make a resolve to change. A change to shatter the tamas, control the rajas, and promote sattva. This needs a change to be worked consciously. So in every action, we must see that we change our behavioral pattern and see that the sattva starts developing. So what are those features of sattva? Three components. Number one, dana, daya, dama. So this is brought out in one of the attractions in our shastras. Once devatas, danavas and the manavas, they all went to the great Lord Vishnu to get some good advice. So Vishnu Bhagavan looked at them and said, da, da, da. You know, what did the rakshasas understand? They have become very cruel. They have become terrorists. Cut others, beat others, terrorize others. So he has said, you have to develop daya, compassion, he said. Devatas, you are rolling in wealth all the time, with all luxuries of the highest concern. So you must control your senses. Don't become slaves to senses. That's called dama. Dama means control over the external senses. Bahirindriya nigraha damaha, it is said. Then what about human beings? You have become too selfish. Everything for you. You know, you don't care what happens outside. And therefore you have to show the dana. You have to bring sharing, sharing, sharing. So these are the three components of sattva. And therefore when we want to develop the sattva, when we want to reduce tamas and rajas, continuous start working on these three aspects. One is giving, giving, giving. Every day you should give something. As I said yesterday, if you don't have anything, you will leave a flower, cup of water, anything can do. But developing the habit of sharing and giving is the key essence. Then showing love and compassion. Then control over the senses, less and less for us, less and less for us. Dhamma are the key features. So then the sattva is going to come up. So yesterday I was mentioning to you that even people who dedicate themselves for completely and they are, have predominant sattva activities also, they also get stuck with various types of NCDs. Asthma, diabetes, hypertension, heart problem, epilepsy, migraine, irritable bowel syndrome and depression and what not. Why? They are all good people. They dedicate themselves to the country, entire world and others. Why should they suffer? It's here that Krishna says that even sattva is not the end. You have to go beyond the sattva. That's called gunatita sthiti. That is the dimension he says. Similarly, another reason as to why you have to go over beyond the three gunas is a conflict. Conflicts arise in our life. And a conflict between ethical norms and duty, which is better of the two. This is the opening scenario of Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna came with all the determination, I am going to win the war, I have the Gandiva, highest weapon, and nobody can win over me. With all the confidence and the faith, and also supported by Krishna Bhagavan, he said, we are going to do. Therefore he asked, please let me know, who are all the people who are going to be in front of me for the war? Please take my ratha to the forefront. Promptly, Krishna Bhagavan takes the chariot to the forefront. Then Krishna starts seeing, Arjuna starts looking at Naturally, he finds all the 100 Kaurava brothers are all there, no surprise. And their arch friend Karna, no surprise. Once he looks here, oh, Krupacharya has come, our Kulaguru. A little surprise. Then he turns, here own great teacher Dronacharya is coming there and standing in front. A much bigger surprise. Then when he looks here, who is the commander-in-chief? Bhishma, Bhishma Pitamaha, the greatest of the Jnani. And he is totally confused. Should I kill all these people? For what? To get the kingship? To have enjoyments? No. We have become very, very wrong. We are doing a big wrong thing. And his intellect starts working. Brilliant logic, he says. I should not do that. In the name of duty, should I kill all these people? Yes, one part of the Buddha says, no, you are a Kshatriya, you have the duty, you have to perform the duty. Go and wage the war and win the war. And Krishna says, Hatova prapsase swargam, jitvava bhakshase mahim. So when you win the war, you get the kingship. And when you get to the heaven, heavenly abode. So it's your duty, you have to do that. And on this side, his heart bleeds with compassion, love, and sacrifice. Then he says to Krishna, should we do that? For what? Yadrajya sukalobena hantum swajanam udyataha vayam. We have come and become so selfish to win the war and get the kingship so that we can have all the luxuries and wealth and others. Is it right? Katham bhishma maham sankhe dronancha madusudana ishubhi pratiyotsyami pujarha varisudana. How can I inflict pain on my own teacher Dronacharya, Kulaguru Krupacharya? And how can I throw my arrows and kill Bhishma? No. Bhishma is worth a worship. We should worship him. On the other side, what we are doing? We are trying to kill him. No. And his mind is in a big confusion. A big conflict, ethics on one side, in which love, compassion, and sacrifice, renunciation, everything on one side coming up. His heart. On the other side, his duty sense. Which is better of the two? Whether duty is better or ethics and morality is better. Which is better? He is confused. So what is the result of that? No? He could not stand the chariot. Gandhi vam sransate hastat tvakchaivata viparidakyate nacha shaknum yavasthatum brahmati vajame manaha. So his Gandhi was coming down. He cannot hold that. And his whole body is trembling. And his mind is full of confusion. And he cannot stand. Rathopastha upavishat. So he sat down. That's the end of the first chapter. So a wonderful presentation, a dramatic presentation of the subtle conflict that arises in all of our lives has been brought forth in the Bhagavad Gita first chapter. And what is the solution? We don't have solutions anywhere in any of the texts in the world. It's only here in the Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads we have the solution. Similarly, there could be a conflict between one ethical norm, another ethical norm. That a surgeon is there, onco-surgeon is there, and he gets a patient, and the diagnosis shows that he has cancer coming up in a very big way. And he knows that patient is very, very nervous. If he tells that he has got cancer, then the success will be very, very less. All surgery he does is not going to work. Therefore, what should be done? Should he tell the truth to the patient and still have the things named Himsa promoted there? He's going to die. Or should he tell the untruth and save? Whether Ahimsa is better or Satya is better between the two. One duty and another duty. Our youngsters were all responding to the call of the freedom movement by Mahatma Gandhi. And thousands and lakhs of people went. And there were few people, youngsters, in whose house there was only one son. And the parents are very sick, very old and very sick. They got a conflict. Whether I should go for the duty of the nation, or should I take care of my parents? Duty for the father and the mother, or duty for the nation. Which is better of the two? One duty and another duty. So this type of conflicts arise, and questioning the very basis of ethics and morality. There is a brilliant talk by the father in the biblical class, and he brought out the whole dimensions of 10 commandments of Christ. And at the end of the class, one of the brilliant students came up and said, "Sir, we marvel at your wonderful oration, and you touched our hearts. Such examples you gave, brilliant. But sir, I have a question. Why should I follow the 10 commandments? That if somebody hits me on the right cheek, you should show the left," you said. "Am I not being exploited? You said that you have to share and give and give. Dana you have to do. Why should I do dana? My heart and money is for my own enjoyment. And if I start giving it to the people, they will become lazy. So why should I give? Should I follow all this thing because it has been told by Christ?" Questioning the very basis of ethics and morality. Same thing here also in our country. We have Manudharma Shastra. He gives the 10 commandments. And whether you should do that. We have Yama Niyama, Patanjali's. Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, Parigraha, Yamaha, Shaucha, Santosha, Tapas, Swadhyaya, Ishwara, Pranidhanani, Niyamaha. 10 do's and don'ts. Why should I follow this? No. When you question the very basics of ethics and morality, then you are lost. The biblical professor had no answer. Similarly, questioning the very basis of duty. Why you are imposing duty? In the name of duty, you are curbing our freedom. Duty for the mother, duty for the father, duty for the student, duty for the king, duty for the minister. Why duty, duty, duty? We should be a free society, and freedom you are curbing. So when you question all these things, there are no answers. So it's only here in the Bhagavad Gita we have these answers. So what are those answers? Yesterday I told that all these three gunas are still the bondages. And what is the component of that bondage in the three gunas? Attachment. Attachment is the key factor of bondage. So Karma Yoga says you must learn how to work without attachment. Asakta asan. Asakta, asanga is the key essence. Very easily said than done. How to do that? Therefore, Krishna gives the secret. So he says that the first secret, karmano hyabibodhavyam bodhavyam cha vikarmanah akarmanascha bodhavyam gahana karmano gatihi. He says, you must understand what is good action, you must know what is bad action. Every one of us know. Tamasic and rajasic actions are bad. Sattvic actions are good. This alone will not solve your problem. This alone will not resolve your conflict. Then what should be done? Akarmanascha bodhavyam. You must also understand the non-action. Our life is not only in action, action, action. There is a lot of our areas of non-action. If you look at our entire life, probably 50% we are not doing action. And only 50% were doing action. Hey, how is it? I'm very busy. I work so much, 15 hours, 16 hours. I'm completely busy during the day. How can I say that I have in non-action? What about sleep in the night? And if you look at the sleep from your childhood to the end of your life, probably we all spend 50% in our akarma, the sleep, non-action. But we don't care for that. So Krishna says this is a big mistake we are doing, because sleep is a necessary thing. Akarma is very, very mandatory. And you know, if you don't have good sleep, how miserable will be next day. So sleep and akarma is a process of rejuvenation. It's a process of deep relaxation. And karma generates stresses, and the akarma releases the stresses. So, stress generation and stress release have been knit into this thing. The nature of karma is to generate the stress. Nature of akarma is to release that. In action, your sympathetic stimulation takes place. In akarma, there is the relaxation dimension, parasympathetic takes place in the body. Autonomic balance is necessary. Therefore, there is good balance. Whatever stress you generate should all be released. If you don't do that, you are bound to have one of the NCDs. So imagine that you generate 100 units in a day through your action. Then all the 100 units should be reduced. If you release only 50%, 60% of that, the remaining 40% is going to accumulate, is going to hit you. You may get spondylosis. You may get back pain. You may have diabetes. You may have any of these modern ailments. Therefore, Krishna says, you must give prominence to akarma. And you must release all the stresses. And akarma is a must, he said. Therefore, every day you must see that you spend enough time for relaxation in the form of sleep or alternate ways by which you can give good relaxation. So in yoga, we have the deep relaxation techniques. Asanas are meant essentially to relax every portion of the body. Every group of muscle can be relaxed. So relaxation, the key essence of asanas. We have to do that. Similarly, pranayama, you're slowing down of the breath. You can use this thing to reduce stresses. So that's the first thing. Therefore, it says, the secret is that you calm down the mind. When you are in such conflict, don't take a decision. Take your time and allow your mind to calm down and then take a decision. When the husband and wife are in a great conflict, values are different, they start fighting. They want to go for a divorce. When they go to the judge, what do they say? Wait, you come after 6 months. Are you sure you want to divorce? They'll say, yes. So, please try to be together for 6 more months and come back. If you still want divorce, then we'll give you. That's the judge. In Houston, an interesting thing happened. The judge who was there in Houston, Texas, in the United States, he has learned the yoga dimension. He knew that such conflict can be resolved by having akarma, having deep relaxation. Therefore, when the husband and wife is to come for a divorce, about 4 or 5 such cases, what he said is, you have to have 6 months. But I suggest, instead of 6 months, I will give you a divorce in a shorter time, only 2 months. They were all very happy. 2 years, 2 months we'll get divorced, 2 months we'll get. What should we do? You go to yoga class. In Houston, we had our coordinator, Sri Ram Rao. So go to Ram Rao's class every day and do these things. And come back after 2 months, They said, very good. Instead of 6 months waiting, we'll have it in 2 months. They all went, started doing the practice. And after 1 month they came and told, we don't want any divorce, we are very happy. So this is the beauty. Such conflicts go away. So therefore, the first and the foremost to resolve such conflict is to calm down the mind, silence the mind, and tune yourself to the akarma. That's the first secret he gives. Then what should happen? Then he says that you have to go to the next step. You have to have that akarma knit into your life. Karmani akarmaya pashyet, akarmani cha karmaya ha, sabuddhiman manushyesho, sayuktaha krishna karma krito. This is one of the most difficult shlokas in Bhagavad Gita to understand. What is the meaning? One who sees non-action in action, and one who sees action in non-action, is the wise, he says. How is it possible? Either you are doing action, or you are not doing action. And Krishna is telling, you must see non-action in action. And he says that you should see action in non-action. Therefore, many people do not understand. And in UK, there was a very great critic. And he said, it is because of such nonsense shlokas that are there, Bhagavad Gita is nonsense. You have to throw it out. He wrote a big critic on that. So, responding to that critic book, one of our great scholars, he said, It's precisely for such special shlokas inserted in Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is so special. Otherwise it will be very ordinary. So what is that? How can you see akarma in karma when you are doing action? How can you see akarma? And how he will be a buddhiman? Once I was traveling in 1978, there was a new railway station that came up in Kanyakumari. Kanyakumari to Nagarkoil, about 15 kilometers. And a new railway track was made and the train was launched. The railway minister had come, a big function was there. He said, for the whole day, it's free travel. Anybody can travel between Kanyakumari to Nagarkoil, Nagarkoil to Kanyakumari. So a lot of villagers in the surrounding area, they had not seen the train. So they were all very happy. And they all started coming, moving from here to there to here. Then we also went to see the special tunnels that I had dug with technological grandeur. So we were all sitting there and the villagers were there, very happy, very excited. And when the train started going faster and faster, then one of the villagers said, you know, see, what a surprise. What? All trees have started moving. All trees have started running. So far they are running. You know, we were also recording. The trees were moving. So what is the difference? We know the trees are not moving. Trees are stationary. This is seeing akarma in karma. Akarma is trees are stationary. What is the karma? You see, your eyes are recording that the trees are moving. That is the karma. Similarly, for a long time we thought that the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, sun is going round the earth. But as we understood our jnana, what happened? No. Sun is not moving. Sun is stationary. And this seeing akarma in karma. This is the dimension. This is what should happen. Therefore, what he says is, in our actions, there should be an inner, deeper understanding. Yogastaha kuru karmani sangam tyaktva dhananjaya siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva samatvam yoga vuchyate, he said. That means you must attune yourself, you must anchor yourself to this silence, to this akarma, and do all actions. First up is recognize the akarma and give prominence to akarma, to the karma. Second is, this akarma should be knit into your life and continuously should be there. How is it possible? So for that, there is a very special way of doing action. That I call it the dual mode operation. What is that special way? You have to recognize the inner layer of the mind and the outer layer of the mind. We are all having that experience. When you are hearing these things, something inside is bugging you. Oh, my father was admitted to the hospital and he undergo a surgery. Day after tomorrow he has a surgery. What is going to happen? Something like inside. You know, something inside is going on. The inner layer of the mind. Are you not familiar with these two layers? The inner layer of the mind and outer layer of the mind. And it's the inner layer of the mind which has to be anchored to that inner silence, inner akarma, inner peace. And outside you do any action. So in Kannada, there's a beautiful book called Mankutimana Kagga. Those who understand Kannada, is a great poet, DVG, D.V. Gundappa. This Mankutimana Kagga is a great Upanishad. In that he gives a secret. Those who know Kannada, they understand this. Yeradu konegala nimmadu manadalayadi virami sobbane mounadolvalamaneya shantiyali horakonayali logaratagalani nadu varayoga sutra vidu mankutimma mankutimma. Recognize that there are two compartments in your mind. The inner compartment and the outer compartment. Inner compartment of the mind, the subtler layer of the mind, should be always in that silence. Should be in that akarma sthiti. Should be in the state of peace, in the state of blissful awareness. Outside you do any activity, doesn't matter. No? Walking, eating, drinking, talking, anything you may be doing outside. Logaratakala neenadu. But inside there should be the. This is a very special way of doing action. I call dual mode operation. So when I am talking, the inner layer of the mind is always in silence. And when you are doing any activity, you may be doing asana, pranayama, meditation, or walking, eating, drinking, anything, inner layer of the mind should be always in akarma. This is to see akarma in karma. Karmani akarmaya parshet is the beautiful secret that Krishna gives. This has to be put into action. And therefore, the secret is that you are detached. Your attachment to actions is gone because you are attached to the inner silence. Yogasthaha kurukonmani. You are attuned to your yogastha sthiti. Attuned to that thing. Therefore, when you do our karma yoga, for example, 45 minutes you go and do outside things, you know. You may be serving in goshala or you may be doing cleaning up the things outside. When you do action, you must learn the special art of keeping your inner silence, keeping your inner blissful awareness, keeping a smile on the face, keeping the inner dimensions of blissful awareness, and do all activities. To give that experience, we give you time for your karma yoga in doing that. You are cleaning, you are removing the glass, you are cleaning up everything outside, you are doing that. This has to be incorporated into the life. When you go back, you may be IT professionals, you are working on the IT computer. But inside, the mind should be calm and silent. Similarly, you may be a housewife, you may be doing the cooking and other things. In all activities, there should be an inner silence. This is how we can convert every action into a yoga. That's the secret Krishna gives here. Therefore, the two secrets. Number one, to recognize the importance of akarma, importance of silence, importance of relaxation, importance of tranquility, importance of calmness of the mind. Compared to action, fast mind, quicker mind, brilliant mind. And that's what Patanjali also said, calm down the mind, silence the mind, the two wings. That's the first recognition. And start incorporating that in the life. And all the time in a silence, doing the action outside. Yogastaha kuru karmani, karmani akarmaya parshe. This is the second secret he gives. The third and the fourth secret we will see tomorrow. Let's contemplate on these thoughts. Sit with the eyes closed. Relax all parts of the body from toes to head. Beautiful smile on the face. Take a deep breath and slowly breathe out. Essential component of yoga is this recognition of akarma and establishing in akarma. All practices are meant essentially to bring this new way of life. First step is to recognize tamas, rajas and sattva. You have freedom to choose our action. Karmane vate adhikaraha. Choose all actions which are sattvic action. Integrity, honesty, transparency, sharing, giving, controlling the senses. Sattvic action, dana, dayadama. That should be the choice. Then while doing even good actions, you should have the special way of doing. A stress-free action. Action in relaxation. Action in inner silence. Dual mode operation. The bhaktas take their ishtadevata and all the time inside the japa goes on of the ishtadevata. Inner layer attuned to that yoga sthiti and doing the outside action. This is the stress-free maturity that we get. A highly efficient action. Otherwise, you get lost in imbalances and conflicts which lead to all NCDs. This is the process of growth that we have to do. As mentioned in our Shanti Mantras, from unreality to reality, darkness to light, from mortality to immortality, to bring peace on earth, to spread the message of happiness and healthy life. Come to Namaskar Mudra.
Asatoma Sadgamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amrutangamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha Sarve Santu Niramayaha Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet Om Shanti Shanti